you want to come down on a Sabbath, you're most welcome. We always have a fellowship lunch afterwards. So you're most welcome. Potluck, so bring something along.
Well, we had a look this morning when I was told there's ordinances, so I thought, well, what do we do?
So here's a little Bible study, if you like, on the significance of what Jesus did with his disciples, and which is now the Lord's Supper, of course, that we have today, and what it means for us. So before we jump in, oh, just a little note, we have this afternoon a talk about this site here. We're going to share about how many believe this is Noah's Ark. You can see the shape here. And the exciting news, last year, I'll tell you all about how God's opened amazing doors, and we're hoping, in fact, if it wasn't for COVID-19, we'd probably be excavating there right now. But God has opened doors to excavate this site. We can share all about that this afternoon. So do come along for that potentially really exciting news. So we're going to look at this morning with the Passover and the New Covenant. So I invite you to bow your heads and invite the Lord to be with us. Our dearest Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank you again for your word. And Lord, as we study your word this morning, we know we're on sure, solid ground. So bless us, Lord, and may your Holy Spirit guide our thoughts and minds. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Now the Passover, of course, if we go back into history, remember Moses was commissioned by God to take his people out of Egypt. And he went back to see Pharaoh, and of course Pharaoh said, no, we're not leaving. So God sent the plagues to help Pharaoh change his mind. We read how God said, they'll know that I'm the Lord when I stretch forth my hand upon Egypt. And of course we can read in Exodus about the 10 plagues. Here's a list of the 10 plagues that God sent, getting worse and worse. And Pharaoh would relent for a while, the plague would be taken away, and then he would change his mind. God will send another plague, and so on, until the last one, number 10, the firstborn being slain. And of course, what God instructed his people to do in this case was to put blood on the doorposts. And where they did that, they would be preserved from that destroying angel. What do you think God was teaching the people here? Clearly, it was salvation, if you like, or escape from death through the blood. God was teaching his people, his laying the foundation for all these principles. So they'll put blood on the upper doorpost and the side doorposts. The Bible says that the blood shall be a token upon the houses where you are. And when I see the blood, I will pass over you. That's the term, the Passover. And the plague shall not be upon you to destroy you when I smite Egypt. And finally, Pharaoh relented. It's still working?
Yep.
Is there anything out there? Pharaoh relented, and it says the people left the very same day out of the land of Egypt. And we could talk all about that. I'll share a little bit some of the pictures of what's in Saudi Arabia. After they crossed through the Red Sea, they came to Mount Sinai. And the Bible tells us this mountain is in Arabia. There's some great documentaries coming out now about where is this location, where is this mountain. And there is a traditional mountain, of course, that many people look to in the Sinai Peninsula, but there's fantastic evidence. The real mountain is actually over here, which is what we call Saudi Arabia today. As the Bible says, Mount Sinai in Arabia, we now call the country Saudi Arabia. Oh, sorry about that. Okay. Technology is wonderful, of course. They're out, we're about to get a break. Yes, there's fantastic evidence that the real Mount Sinai, the evidence, is actually over here. And I'll share some of that now. I was able to get to Saudi Arabia 4 years ago. A very difficult country to go to. A very difficult place. A friend of mine arranged business visas, so he'd go on a business trip. And so, sorry, it's a bit washed out. But it's like a cigarette, isn't it? In the background, I was going to say, you can see the black and pink, but all you can see is a white out there. But there's amazing evidence. There's this fenced off area. The government, the Saudi government, has fenced off this area in the base of this mountain. And there are signs up which say this is an archaeological area. It's unlawful to trespass.
read the signs there. It's interesting, it's in both Arabic and English, and you don't see many signs in English in Saudi Arabia. And behind that fence, where it says you're not allowed to go, he's been a bit naughty going behind it, but there's amazing carvings. You have to do the selfie these days, don't you? So here's the selfie. But notice this carving here. This is carved on these rocks. Now, what is this? It is a... looks pretty crude, doesn't it? A bull. Now, here's a picture from an Egyptian tomb showing the paintings they would have of the Apis bulls the Egyptians would worship. You can see the different colour schemes they have, the different models, if you like. Notice particularly this one here. Can you see the coloration on that one there, the top right? You think somebody familiar with that has tried to depict it here. Can you see that? And yet, this is in Saudi Arabia, a desert where there's not much vegetation. And obviously, cattle need a lot of water from the grass. So what's it doing depicted in Saudi Arabia? But not far away, there's another rock, which is a bit hard to see there. But where I'm pointing with my finger, can you see this here? Mm. Here's the bull, if you like. And underneath, can you see that human figure sort of doing this? What's that all about? And here's another one, not far away, just across the rock from it. Here's a human figure holding the tail of the bull. Do you see that? What's this all about? Well, again, if we go back to Egypt and look at the bull they worshipped in Egypt, here's a carving of the Apis bull that the Egyptians worshipped. And can you see these elements? What do you see? In the back here? There's someone holding the tail. And can you see underneath here? Someone doing this. This is the Apis bull worship. So it's been depicted here in Saudi Arabia at this mountain. Where do you think that came from? There's a lot more evidence. I'll share one more quick thing here. And again, sorry.
It's out.
Sorry, it's washed out. Never mind. Hopefully this one, but trust me, I'll show you on the screen later if you like. There is a depiction of a seven branch candlestick. You might better see it on here.
Yeah, we can.
I can turn it on. Is that true?
Just pick it up.
Just pick it up.
All right, never mind. Oh, okay. Can you see me? That's a bit clearer.
Oh.
Yeah, I'll put it here like that for now.
Okay. Thanks. Does that make sense? Yeah, so what you can see here is the seven branch candlestick. This is carved on these rocks. Can you think of any religion that has seven branch candlestick? And went to a mountain in Arabia. Well, they worship the golden calf anyway, you know, right? So there's fantastic evidence this mountain in Arabia is the real Mount Sinai. If these things have been found at the traditional mountain, so there you go, what more proof do you need? But it's not a natural location, it's here in Arabia. So I'll put to you, the Exodus route is more likely this. Crossing the desert, crossing the Red Sea here in the Gulf of Aqaba, and some amazing things have been found when you go diving to a mountain over here. Anyway, let's look at some lessons we can learn from this. What took place at this mountain? And this is where God was going to form a covenant with the people that he'd taken out of Egypt. And as they're coming up to the mountain, in chapter 19, before he speaks the Ten Commandments, he says, "Now therefore, if you will obey my voice indeed and keep my covenant, then ye shall be a peculiar treasure unto me above all people." God was going to have a covenant with these people, something he'd never done to a nation before. They're going to be a special people. And so Moses, it says, came and called for the elders of the people, and laid before their faces all these words which the Lord had commanded him. And all the people answered him and said, "All that the Lord has spoken, we will do." So they say, yes, we want to have this covenant with this amazing God that opened the Red Sea for us and took us out of Egypt. And then God came down upon the mountain. It says Mount Sinai was altogether on smoke because the Lord descended upon it in fire and smoke. Thereof ascended as the smoke of the furnace, and the mountain quaked greatly.
would have been amazing. Here, God spoke audibly to this multitude of people, perhaps 2 million people, his commandments, his will. And we read later in the chapter, after God spoke the Ten Commandments, as all the people saw the thunderings and the lightnings and the noise of the trumpet and the mountain smoking. And when the people saw it, they removed and stood afar off. And they said unto Moses, speak thou with us, and we'll hear. But let not God speak with us, lest we die. It must have been pretty frightening to be there. And so Moses became the go-between between the people and God. And it says, Moses, the people stood afar off, and Moses drew near to the thick darkness where God was. And the Lord said unto Moses, thus thou shalt say to the children of Israel. And if we had time this morning, we could go through Exodus 21 to 24. These are the statutes and judgments which God gave Moses to share with the people. Moses became the mediator, if you like, between the Hebrews and the God that they worship up on the mountain there. And so Moses, after hearing all this, comes back down. And he told the people all the words of the Lord and all the judgments. And all the people answered with one voice and said, all the words which the Lord has said will we do. So they've got the picture, right? Moses comes back and explains, this is what God expects of you in this covenant. And do they agree? Yes, they say, we will do this. Then to make it crystal clear, it says Moses wrote all the words of the Lord. And he took the book of the covenant and read it in the audience of the people. And they said, all that the Lord has said, will we do and be obedient. So they've got it three times to get the picture. They're really clear. This is the covenant that God wanted with these people. Now, because they've got the message, they've heard the covenant, they've agreed to it, they then had this special one-off ceremony to ratify this covenant. They all gathered around. And the book of Hebrews, it summarizes it really nicely. It says, when Moses had spoken every precept to all the people according to the law, he took, and notice this, the blood of calves and goats with water. So blood and water, keep that in mind. And scarlet wool and hyssop, and sprinkled both the book and all the people, saying, this is the blood of the testament which God has enjoined on. So do you see what's going on here? He gets this little piece of hyssop and a bit of wool, and he makes a sprinkling from what he's doing. He sprinkles the people, sprinkles the book, basically saying, you people are agreeing to abide by this covenant. You see that? And that's how the old covenant was ratified. That was kind of like the start of the marriage, if you like, between God and his people. Amazing. It would have been incredible to have been in the scene of this. And this is the process. Now, God gave some admonitions to the people. He said, you shall not add unto the word which I command you, neither shall ye diminish aught from it, that ye may keep the commandments of the Lord your God which I command you. And in another place he said this, what things soever I command you, observe to do it, thou shalt not add thereto, nor diminish from it. And you can understand that, can't you? If you've got an agreement with somebody or a covenant, you need to abide by that. Does that make sense? You can't sort of unilaterally change. Like if you had a contract for someone to come and mow your lawns for you, and you both signed it, the agreement, the man who mows the lawns, and you can't later, when the guy goes away, say, I'm going to change this. Instead of coming every 2 weeks, I'll make it every week. You know? You understand? Once agreement is signed, both parties have agreed, one party can't change that agreement without the agreement of the other. Does that make sense? And that's what God is saying here. Don't change this agreement you've got. And this was like a marriage between God and his people. You find this theme throughout the Bible. Although make was thine husband, it says in Isaiah. In Hosea, he said, I will betroth thee unto me forever. But was Israel a faithful bride? Sadly, at Mount Sinai. What happened? You remember that golden calf incident? Probably on top of that pile of rocks where those things were carved. This took place. And God, throughout
all the Old Testament, we read the sad story of how Israel wandered away from God. Here's from Isaiah. Our sinful nation, a people laden with iniquity, a seed of evildoers, children that are corruptors. They have forsaken the Lord. They have provoked the Holy One of Israel into anger. They have gone away back there. And you see this all through the Old Testament, Sandy. Here's from Jeremiah. Turn, O backsliding children, says the Lord, for I am married unto you. This was God's bride, if you like, his nation, his people. And they are wandering away from him. And Jeremiah says, surely as a wife treacherously departed from her husband, so have you dealt treacherously with me, O house of Israel, says the Lord. What was the problem here? Was God not faithful in this agreement? No, it wasn't God, was it? And in Hebrews it says, for finding fault with them, he said, behold, the days come, says the Lord, when I'll make a new covenant with the house of Israel. Now that's in the book of Hebrews, and Paul here is quoting from Jeremiah. Behold, the days come, says the Lord, that I'll make a new covenant with the house of Israel and the house of Judah, says in Jeremiah 31. Not according to the covenant that I made with their fathers, which my covenant they break, although I was a husband unto them, says the Lord. Here's this marriage thing coming through again. You see that? And sadly, the people broke this beautiful covenant that they had on the Son. He goes on to say that this shall be the covenant that I'll make with the house of Israel after those days, says the Lord. I will put my law in their inward parts and write it in their hearts, and will be their God, and they shall be my people. What was the problem with the old covenant? Remember what the people said? They said, all that the Lord has said, we will do. And you know, there's a nice statement in the Spirit of Prophecy. All our promises are like ropes of sand. Have you heard that expression? You imagine building a rope of sand. We as human natures, with our fallen nature, we tend to fall down like that. We fall into this category. But God says, I will put my will in your place. The new covenant's based on better promises because it's God promising, not our promises. Does that make sense? Hence it says in the Hebrews, better promises. Now, everything in the Old Covenant was foreshadowing something. All those sacrifices, every sacrifice pointed to the one sacrifice of the New Covenant, Jesus on the cross. Even the Old Covenant was foreshadowing the New Covenant. So just as Moses was the mediator in the Old Covenant, who was the mediator of the New Covenant? Jesus, exactly. This is not rocket science. He doesn't know this. Jesus, the mediator of the new covenant. Now, if we jump forward to the end of his ministry, when you have the Last Supper, there's some interesting things we can glean from this, very important principles. It says, when the hour was come, he sat down and the 12 apostles with him. Now, what took place, this is the end of Jesus' ministry, and the disciples were still jostling amongst themselves who was going to be the greatest. Remember the background? Remember, was it the mother of James and John came to Jesus one day and said, I have a request. And Jesus said, what is it? And she said, when you're in your kingdom, I'd like my two sons to sit either side of me. Remember that? And the other disciples were not happy with where they were. And even here at the Last Supper, they're still arguing about who's going to be the greatest. And the reading of the Spirit of Prophecy, Judas made sure he sat next to Jesus at this Last Supper. And so it says, there was a strife among them, which of them should be accounted the greatest. And how did Jesus solve this problem? In fighting, if you like, amongst his top 12 disciples. And we know the story. It says, he rises from supper and began to wash the disciples' feet. Now this was the job of a servant. And of course, they're all bickering about who's going to be the greatest. None of them would do this. So Jesus took on that role. And the message wasn't lost on them. They got the message. Amazing. Except Peter, of course. You know, Peter's always starts from this to him. Peter said unto him, thou shalt never wash my feet. Jesus answered him, if I wash thee not, thou hast no part with me. So Simon Peter said unto the Lord, not my feet only, but my hands and my head. So this is important, isn't it? Now notice what Jesus says, and this is why today we're going to do something, I'll put this right here, something which many churches don't do. But this is absolutely straight out of the Bible, and here it is. So after he had washed their feet, he said unto them, if I then, your Lord and Master, have washed your feet, ye also ought to wash one another's feet. In fact, he went on to say this, I have given you an example that ye should do as I have done to you. If you know these things, happy are ye if you do them. And yet, how many churches do they follow this? Not many. There are only a few churches that do. But there is right out of the scriptures, Jesus lives in his own name. Then he had the Passover meal. It says he took bread and gave thanks and broke it and gave it unto him, saying, this is my body which is given for you. This do in remembrance of me. Likewise also the cup after supper, saying, this cup is the New Testament in my blood, which is shed for you. Something interesting I want to point out, and we'll see why this is significant in a second. He's saying, this do in remembrance of me. And he's saying, this cup is my blood. And yet Jesus hadn't shed his blood at this point, had he? He's introducing a memorial of his death before he went to the cross. Wonder why? We'll touch on that shortly. Just keep that thought in mind. I'd like to hear something else interesting. If we look at how the Jews keep the Passover, this was the Passover that Jesus was keeping. Use it to introduce what we have with now as the Lord's Supper. If we don't look at the Passover for a moment, there's some very interesting things. What the Jews do today, and they've done this for generations, millennia, is they'll have this little bag, and inside the bag are three pieces of bread. And here's a, this is from the Jewish website. Yeah, I'm sorry.
It's
hard to see. I'll read it off here. This is from a Jewish website. It's called myjewishlearning.com. It's for Jewish people. This is what it says. At the Passover cedar table, the Passover meal table, three matzahs are placed in a stack. The matzah is the Passover bread, the unleavened bread that the Jews use. Near the beginning of the cedar, which is the meal, the middle matzah is broken in two pieces, and the larger piece of this matzah is called the afikoman. It is saved to be eaten after the meal. So you get that little bag of three pieces of unleavened bread. They take the middle one out and they break it. And then they put it in its own little bag and they hide it. It goes on to say this, many families have a custom of hiding the afikoman. Either the parents hide it and the children search for it, or the children hide it and the parents search. A prize is often given to whoever locates this important piece of matzah. The cedar cannot continue until the afikoman has been located and consumed. Now there's a website called Rock of Israel. These are Messianic Jews. Jews have become Christians, and oh, you can see the URL here. And they explain from a Jewish perspective, a Jewish Christian perspective, of what this means. Have you ever seen this before? It's really interesting. It says, the Mishnah, which is ancient Jewish writings, instructs that the Passover lamb should be the last food eaten the night of the cedar. So because there are no more lambs served at the cedar, the afikoman is now a substitute for the Passover sacrifice. And there's a reference to the Talmud here. Look that up. It goes on to say, you see, since the destruction of the temple in the year 70 AD, the afikoman has now become a symbolic reminder of the Passover lamb that we used to eat, but no longer do. So you get the picture, they don't have a temple anymore. Instead of sacrificing the lamb on the Passover, they use this little piece of bread instead.
home and is eaten for dessert after the cedar meal in commemoration of the Paschal, the Passover sacrificial lamb. Since that sacrifice was supposed to be the last thing eaten at Passover, the afikomen has now taken its place. The afikomen custom has been happening for millennia in Jewish homes. So what does it mean? It says, what about the meaning of the three-layered pouch where the afikomen came from? No one has a definitive answer. Some say it represents the priests, the Levites, and the rest of the Israelites. Others say it reminds us of the two patriarchs, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. That's how the Jews understand it, you see.
Mm-hmm.
Then they ask this, but why would the middle one, the Levites, or Isaac, be broken?
Mm-hmm.
And then they say this, however, Messianic Jews again rejoice at this. Why? Because we believe there is only one God, like there is only one pouch, yet this one God has three distinct areas / persons. Father, Abba, Son, Messiah, and Holy Spirit. Ruach HaKodesh, that means the Holy Spirit of the Hebrew. So the one mitzvah tosh, with the three layers, and the middle matzah being broken, buried, and brought back, is a beautiful picture of the Messiah of Israel.
Mm.
He left heaven and came to earth. He was indeed broken, buried, and brought back. And the afikomen, Messiah Yeshua, is still alive. He was the God of Israel, visiting us in human form, which has happened before, and we'll give some references. So here's some Messianic Jews saying, our brothers, the Jews, don't understand what they're doing. Every Passover they have this pouch with three pieces of bread. The middle one's taken out and broken, then it's put in a little bag and hidden. And the children have to go and find it and bring it out again. They're saying, they can't see it. Jesus.
Mm.
The substitute, they don't have a lamb anymore, they use this piece of bread. And look what happens to that piece of bread. Mm. It's a little story of Jesus' ministry, his death and resurrection. Amazing. And so this is what Jesus was using at the Passover to say, well, what did he say? Earlier he said, I am the living bread which came down from heaven. If any man eat of this bread, he shall live forever. And the bread that I will give is my flesh, which I give for the life of the world. Amazing. Now looking at the clock, if we've got time, there's something else I'd like to share regarding what took place when Jesus died at this Passover. In the passage we looked at before, where he took bread and gave thanks and broke it and gave it unto them, saying, this is my body which is given to you, this do in remembrance of me. Likewise, he took the cup, saying, this cup is the New Testament in my blood which is shed for you. So when he had that cup, he says, this is my blood of the New Testament. Now that word testament there, oh, you can see that word. The word testament there is the same word in Greek where we read earlier in Hebrews where it talks about the new covenant. Remember in Hebrews, God says, I'll make a new covenant with the house of Israel. That word covenant and that word testament is the same word in Greek. It's exactly the same word. Testament, covenant, interchangeable. And what's the significance of this? Well, the meaning of it is, it's like a will. For example, this definition here from Strong's, it says, the last disposition on which one makes of his earthly possessions after his death, a testament or a will. Follow me? Do anyone know what a testament or a will is? Have you ever been to a lawyer's office and said, now I'd like to make my will? My wife over here, they don't. She works in the lawyer's office and she does wills for people. People come to her and say, look, I'd like to do my will. Isn't that right, Dan? Yes. And they will specify, when I pass away, this is what I would like to have happen. You're all familiar with that, aren't you? Yes, exactly. And when does that come into effect? Until the person dies, it's only a piece of paper in the safe of the office at Beatty Whitney Levy, is that right? So it sits there on file. It doesn't have any force. The person come along later and change it, is that right? They come back and say, oh, I want to make some alterations here. It's just a piece of paper. When does it come into effect? When the person dies. Exactly. And this is exactly what it says in the book of Hebrews regarding this thing. For where a testament is, or a will, there must also of necessity be the death of the testator. For a testament is, of course, after many years. Otherwise, it's of no strength at all while the testator lives. Do you understand the principle here? Very simple. A will doesn't come into force until the person whose will it is passes away. You see that? So the testator, who's the testator? That's the person whose will it is. Now, we're looking at what Jesus did here. We're talking about the New Testament. So who was the testator of the New Testament? Jesus, exactly. So when was the death of the testator of the New Testament? Calvary, exactly. This is not rocket science. When Jesus came to the cross, he died. And that was the death of the testator of the New Testament. For Christ, even Christ our Passover, the sacrifice for us. As he's on the cross, he cried with a loud voice, "It is finished," and gave up the ghost. And the veil in the temple was ripped in half, wasn't it? Remember that? God was saying, this old sacrificial system is finished, it's gone. Coming out of a new covenant. And something very significant took place just after he had died. It says, one of the soldiers with a spear pierced his side, and forthwith came there out, notice this, blood and water. And notice what John says in the next verse. He that saw it bear record, and his record is true, and he knoweth that he said true, that you might believe. We'll have to read the reference here. It's John 19, 34 and 35. See what John is saying? He says, believe it, I saw it, it happened. Blood and water came from Jesus' side. Why is John drawing attention to this fact here? What in the Jewish mind would the blood and water together draw their minds to? What did Moses do at Mount Sinai? What did he use to ratify the old covenant? Blood and water. What did John see come out of Jesus' side? Blood and water. Moses was ratifying the old covenant. Jesus is, what's he doing? Ratifying the new covenant. He's bringing in his will of life, his testament. This is the death of the testator, and it's ratifying the new covenant. So the parallel is Moses used blood and water to ratify the old covenant. Jesus is now ratifying the new covenant, blood and water. Who's buried. But the good news is, of course, the tomb couldn't hold Jesus. So even though Jesus died, we serve a risen Savior, is that right? Mm-hmm. That's the wonderful news. After he rose, he gave instructions to his disciples. He taught them for 3.5 years, taught them baptism, beautiful teachings and doctrines. He introduced the Lord's Supper. Can you see why he introduced the Lord's Supper before he died? Because once the covenant is ratified, nothing can be changed. You realize that? That's why God says, don't add to it, you can't add to it or diminish aught from it. Jesus had to introduce the memorial of his death before he died, so that when he died on Calvary and ratified that covenant, the Lord's Supper was part of the new covenant. You follow that? He couldn't, after he had risen, call them all together and say, right, we're going to have a meal now, and give you a memorial of my death. Because it wouldn't be part of the new covenant. Do you see that? He had to introduce it before he died, so it would be ratified as part of the New Testament. He couldn't add to it later. And so here at the commission, he's saying, now go teach all nations, baptize them, teaching them to observe all things whatsoever I have commanded you. In other words, during the 3.5 years, he gave them all instruction. He died and ratified the new covenant. Now he's saying, go and teach this to all the nations. It's very simple. Notice he didn't say,
to go back to Jerusalem and have a church council meeting and decide what day you want to keep.
Did he say that?
He didn't say go back to Jerusalem and decide what sort of baptism you want. He said simply teach everybody what I've already taught you. Does that make sense? So the new covenant, to understand the new covenant, we simply have to look at what did Jesus teach during his ministry? Very simple. And of course they went back and they waited for the Holy Spirit to come to do that. And the Holy Spirit was for them. And Paul stresses in the New Testament, once a covenant is confirmed, you cannot add to it or disannul from it. You see, this is New Testament text here. He says, brethren, I speak after the manner of men, though it be but a man's covenant, if it be confirmed, no man disannul it forever. Much more so is implying God's covenant. And that word covenant there is the same word again, that testament or covenant. And God said, my covenant you are not breaking, nor alter it from this one out of my lips. Now we know that Jesus established one faith, isn't that right? One Lord, one faith, one baptism. So why do we see such a multitude of options in the world today, all under the guise of Christianity? And there's a long story, and you could do a whole talk on this, but the bottom line is a power arose over the world that believed it could change what God had established. Can you read that?
Mm-hmm.
The Pope has power to change times, to abrogate laws, and dispense with all things, even the precepts of Christ. Do you believe that?
Mm-hmm.
Not at all. When Jesus died and established the new covenant, nobody had the right to come along and say, well, let's tweak some things here. We don't like the way baptism works. Let's do it by sprinkling. Much more convenient. Do you understand? Nobody can come along and change what Jesus established. And that's why we see so many multitude of churches there, because they don't understand the principle that once it was ratified, it cannot be altered. Jesus says, you are my friends if you do whatsoever I command. He said, why call you me Lord, Lord, and do not the things which I say? Because he followed other commands. It says, the outcome of the now is when true worshippers shall worship the Father in spirit and in truth, for the Father seeketh such to worship him. So if you want to be a totally faithful, Bible-believing, Jesus-following, covenant-keeping Christian, what church do you think you should have? Why are we here this morning? Why aren't we coming to church tomorrow? Because, exactly, Jesus said, remember the seventh day of the Lord. Saturday is the seventh day. It's not for us to say, well, Saturday is not going to be in the right plan, maybe in the day. Let's make it Sunday at church. Is that what we can do? So, that's why we should be at this, because we want to follow Jesus 100%. Is that right? The one church that adheres 100% to that old covenant, not 90% or 85%, but 100% to what Jesus established at the cross, is this church here. And also Tiago as well. So yes, this afternoon, if you like, we're going to talk about the wonderful plan. We're working with the government to excavate this site, so we'll talk about that this afternoon.